Good afternoon. Thank you, everyone, for coming. We're grateful that you've taken the time out of your day to join us for what I hope is an interesting and dynamic conversation. My name is Shawn Whatley. I'm a Munk Senior Fellow at the Macdonald-Laurier Institute, which is hosting today's event. The event will kind of flow as follows. I'll take the next hour and a half or so to share some brief remarks, and then we'll have a panel come up and take about an hour and a half. We should have you back to work around 4 or 5. In fact, I'm going to speak briefly to help contextualize, hopefully, an interesting and dynamic panel. And I think it speaks to the strengths of Macdonald-Laurier Institute that we have a panel that will be able to tackle these issues in a way that reflects the diversity of opinion that is presently part of this policy debate, and most importantly, get at the nuance that is animating this debate. I think we all agree that one of the problems in and around the debate we've had now for the past 24 months or so is a lack of nuance, a lack of proper definition, a lack of understanding of what precisely we're debating, and hopefully we can help illuminate those questions today. Before I get started, though, I'd be remiss if I didn't take the opportunity to talk briefly about the Macdonald-Laurier Institute, which pays part of my salary. The Macdonald-Laurier Institute is a public policy think tank here in the national capital, dedicated to the full range of issues for which the federal government's responsible. So not only are we tackling issues in and around Pharmacare and the regulation of drugs, we've also tackled issues ranging from economic and fiscal policy to more recently foreign policy and national security issues. I think if Brian Crowley, the managing director, was here, he would boast about the work that we're doing on global affairs, on foreign policy, on issues ranging from Canada's relationship with China to issues in and around India and the broader Southeast Asia world of geopolitics. And so we're only able to carry out the work because of the support of people like you here in the room. And for that, we're grateful, and not just because you help pay my rent. And with that, let me just open up briefly today on the subject of Pharmacare, and as I say, help to contextualize the interesting panel conversation, which will soon follow. We convene, of course, at an important juncture for this file. March federal budget made some initial down payments on a possible Pharmacare model, including a new Canadian drug agency and national formulary. We anticipate further recommendations in the Hoskins panel final report in the coming weeks, and there's a strong possibility that Pharmacare will loom large in the upcoming federal election campaign. As I referred to earlier, we regret at the Macdonald-Laurier Institute that the issue has become polarized along various lines. This has regrettably led to a binary debate about a national single-payer Pharmacare model or an affirmation of the status quo. We think that's a false choice and the wrong way to think about drug coverage and the role of public policy in Canada. We've argued instead that a single-payer arrangement may be the wrong answer, it is absolutely the right question. And instead, we've sought to put forward alternative approaches that we believe represents the proper answer to the right question. And as I say, I think that'll be illuminated in today's panel discussion. It seems to me, though, as I mentioned earlier, one of the principal problems with this debate is a lack of agreement on definitions, a lack of agreement on what precisely we're trying to achieve. And so it seems to me we have to start with all public policy questions. What is the problem we're trying to solve? It seems like a straightforward question, but it's become clear in the past 24 months or so that it's not. There's a multiplicity of answers, including but not limited to providing drug coverage for the uninsured or underinsured, establishing a cap on catastrophic drug costs, lowering drug prices and out-of-pocket spending for individuals, equalizing access to drugs amongst individuals and across the country, reducing costs for provinces and territories, and solving for Medicare's original sin of excluding drugs from public coverage roughly 50 years ago. I list these various perspectives because, as I say, identifying the right problem is essential for developing the right solution. there's insufficient time here for me to address each of them, and no doubt the panel will have differing views on these questions and what they may mean for policymakers. But I would argue that one of the main reasons that this policy debate has become so polarized is because a set of unclear or competing interpretations of the problem. If I may, let me be clear about how we've come to see and understand this issue at the Macdonald-Laurier Institute. We've principally viewed it through the lens of the first problem, that is an insurance gap in Canada. There's a small yet growing share of Canadians without drug insurance. This insurance gap strikes us as a legitimate problem justifying policy thinking. Our research has identified approximately 10% of the population as uninsured. The Hoskins panel cites 20% when one also incorporates those who are underinsured. But notwithstanding these definitional or measurement differences, we agree that policymakers should be concerned with the uninsured in part because of out-of-pocket spending can be regressive, and in part because, as I'll describe in a moment, there's a strong likelihood that this group continues to grow due to labor market trends. The next question is, who are these people? The good news is we know a bit about them. A large share is neither poor nor old. They're also unlikely to live in a rural or remote community. Otherwise, they'd ostensibly be covered, as 23% of the population is, by provincial programs that target low-income people, seniors, or rural residents, such as the Ontario Trillium Drug Program. Incidentally, the Conference Board, the Canadian Health Policy Institute, and others have pointed out that the percentage covered by public programs could be even higher, but a significant number of Canadians, ranging somewhere between 3.6 million and 4.1 million, are eligible yet unenrolled in these public programs due to a lack of awareness or some other personal choice. This gap in take-up may mean that these programs need to be better designed or that governments need to do a better job promoting awareness. But setting that aside for a second, unlike another 66% of Canadians, this uninsured cohort doesn't have a private drug coverage through an employer, a spouse, or as an individual. This presumably means that they're unattached or work for small firms or involved in non-standard employment such as the gig economy, nonprofit work, or self-employment. This is worth emphasizing. Our research estimates that 2.8 million, or roughly 80% of the non-insured cohort, actually finds itself in the self-employed category. These characteristics mean this cohort is generally working age and an earning income that exceeds the mean testing threshold of public programs. It doesn't mean policymakers shouldn't care about this group, but it may change how we think about the role of government and public policy. While this is a unique cohort, it's not necessarily a vulnerable one. There is, however, as I alluded to earlier, a good chance that it grows. Changing patterns in the labor force, in particular the rise in non-standard work, probably means that traditional work-based benefits will face strain. We've already seen shifts in workplace pensions. It's conceivable we begin to observe similar declines in other employer-provided benefits, such as drug coverage. As an example, a recent discussion paper released by the expert panel on modern federal labor standards observes that such coverage falls significantly for, quote, permanently part-time employees or, quote, temporary employees. As a growing share of our workforce finds itself in these non-standard forms of employment, it's possible that our uninsured cohort increases. This doesn't mean, however, that we face a crisis, as some have argued. Even the Hoskins panel 20% figure implicitly recognizes that the current mix of public and private insurance is providing near universal coverage of the Canadian population. Various polls tell us that the vast majority of Canadians are generally satisfied with the access and cost of prescription drugs. But it also doesn't mean that the status quo isn't without any need of reform. 1 in 10 Canadians currently doesn't have insurance, and that figure may rise over time. It seems sensible for policymakers to address this need of this small yet possible growing cohort. The next step then is to consider our policy options. The Hoskins panel describes two basic approaches. The first, a fill the gaps policy response that targets the uninsured, or second, a broad-based single-payer model with coverage ranging from essential medicines to a more comprehensive formulary. There are different variations embedded in each approach, but as a policy-making framework, it's useful for judging the various options. And maybe I will save for our discussion some of those variations and how we might think about them. Before I turn it over to the panel, I'd be remiss if I didn't take the opportunity to talk briefly about one particular policy option that we've developed and thought about and talked about at the Macdonald-Laurier Institute. It would involve a major redesign of the federal medical expense tax credit in order to help people purchase private insurance. The MATC, as some of you know, is a non-refundable tax credit for certain itemizable above-average medical or disability-related expenses. It's been around in different forms since 1942. Roughly 5 million tax filers claim it each year. It costs the government approximately $1.8 billion annually in foregone revenue. The MATC's design is complex. The value of the credit is calculated by applying the lowest personal income tax rate of 15% to the amount of qualifying medical expenses in excess of the lesser of 3% of net income, or $2,302. There's no upper limit on the amount that can be claimed except for certain specific expenses. Premiums paid to private health insurance plans are currently an eligible expense, but the METC is presently too small to make a difference. It's non-refundable, its minimum threshold is too high, and the overall value is too low. We've written in favor of a significant redesign to help uninsured Canadians acquire private insurance. How should that reform take shape? The tax credit should be refundable. The threshold should be reset. The value should be higher. Basically, the new tax credit should apply to first dollar spending and be more generous than 15%. Suppose, for instance, you set the value of the credit at $5,000 per family, or $2,500 per individual for purchasing insurance. There'd be room, of course, to adjust these amounts on a sliding scale based on income or health status. But the key point is it would provide substantial public support for individuals and families to purchase different forms of private insurance, ranging from basic plans to more enhanced benefits. It would, in effect, leverage the best features of the current hybrid model. Jack Mintz, who most of you know, has estimated that it could cost roughly $5 billion per year, depending on its design and any offsetting changes elsewhere. There are two benefits, in my view, to this targeted solution. I would just flag two. The first is that reforming federal support for acquiring supplementary insurance, including for drugs, would presumably reduce the number of uninsured households and, in turn, reduce fiscal pressure on provincial and territorial budgets. Think of it as a way for Ottawa to help subnational governments without offending federalism or harming the strengths of the current system. The second is it would recognize the current policy asymmetry between the non-taxation of employer-provided health and dental benefits and the lack of public support for those, like me, who must purchase them with after-tax dollars. Leveling the playing field will not only address a basic inequity, it may also shift the insurance model over time from a work-based one to an individual-based framework. This would better reflect labor market trends by ensuring that drug insurance is portable and protected irrespective of one's workplace circumstances. We happen to believe, therefore, that this is a clever solution that policymakers ought to consider. But the more fundamental point is they should focus on a targeted solution for the small yet real share of the population that primarily that presently doesn't have drug coverage. This can come in the form of a redesigned METC, possible expansions of provincial programs similar to OHIP Plus, or some other proposal. These incremental steps would make progress on the 10 to 20% problem that the Hoskins panel has rightly identified in its interim report. And maybe with that, I will stop and invite the panel, not just to as I said earlier, share their perspectives on appropriate solutions, but to try to think about this in a logical way. What is the problem we're trying to solve? And from that, what is the right set of solutions, and which is the right level of government to address these problems? Thank you very much. Thank you for being here. And with that, I just ask our panelists to come up and join us. So I said earlier, one of the strengths of the Macdonald-Laurier Institute, one of the reasons that I'm proud to be associated with the Institute is the quality of people that we're able to, and the minds that we're able to bring to bear on the big policy issues facing our country. And today is no different. I was going to introduce each of the panelists to you, but I realized that I didn't have enough bandwidth to keep track of all of their affiliations and associations and accolades. And so maybe what we'll do is I'll start with the first question, and as part of their answers, I would just ask the panelists to share with you their background and experiences and the perspective that they bring to bear on these questions. And so I think, at least it's the way that my mind works, I think the first question to put to the panel is there a problem? And what problem ought to animate public policymakers as they think about drug coverage in Canada, as they think about whether and how we ought to adopt a national pharmacare model.
So I can start. Thank you very much. My name is Durham Wong Rieger, and I am the president and CEO of the Canadian Organization for Rare Disorders. And I am also the chair of the board for Rare Disease International, which is the international alliance of rare disease organizations across the world, as well as international rare disease groups. And the reason I put that into the context is I have just returned this past week from the World Health Organization, where we chair two panels, two forums, one an official forum within the WHA on rare diseases. The first time rare diseases has come up in the WHO, and earlier this February, we chaired a non-governmental organization committee at the United Nations on rare diseases. And while, you know, my context starts with rare diseases, because obviously that's where I'm doing a lot of the work, and I also represent within Canada about 100 and so rare disease organizations that are made up, as you know, of people that are affected by rare diseases. And I guess in some respects, when you say, is there a problem and what is the problem, I would say what you missed in all of your opening comments, which were, if I could have followed more of them, would I have been truly brilliant, because I recognize how complex it is. And we recognize that there are lots of people that need to solve different parts of it. So even as patients, we don't say, okay, it's a simplistic solution, we should just do X. But where I think it's important is that when you say a dose of reality, I think we are your dose of reality. The patients are. And what I didn't hear is actually what matters most to patients and what the reality is for many patients, whether they have rare diseases or any other kind of conditions, is being able to get access to the right medicine for their condition. It isn't coverage. A lot of people have coverage, and they still don't get access to the medicines. There are a lot of people that actually have access to the current medicines, but what they really need is that other medicine that is being taken place. My husband, for instance, has Parkinson's disease. The new medicine we're looking at is one that would actually help his neurological conditions. Guess what? He'd have to travel to a clinical trial in the U.S. to get it. We don't have that trial in Canada. So I think the reality for many patients in Canada is, in fact, assuring that we've got a system that gets individuals to the right medicines, to the right treatment, and it may not just be a medicine, to have a system around them that actually supports that medicine regardless of what kind of coverage they've got. So what I urge everybody to do when they're, you know, thinking through each of their, you know, areas, which I think are essential, whether it's the policy area, the regulatory area, the access rules around it, even the pricing area, is to be really driven by the reality of most patients, and that is, how do I get the right medicine for me when I need it or for my child when I need it? That's our only reality. And if we can be driven towards that and we can make sure that everything dovetails back to that reality, then I think we'll be a long way ahead.
Matthew?
Thanks, Shawn, for the introduction. I didn't realize that you had access to my computer and was stealing all my material. Yeah, my name's Matthew Broham. I'm the funny accent is from New Zealand, not Australia. Just let's get that straight. I'm an independent consultant and working to the pharmaceutical sector. I used to run New Zealand's national pharmacare program. New Zealand only has one, so I guess that's part of the reason why I'm here in front of you, is to sort of be able to share or at least answer some comments with respect to what's happening or has happened in New Zealand with a single payer kind of system. And actually, to just put that to bed right away, Canada will never look like New Zealand. So you will not see what you see in New Zealand and Canada. In terms of the problem, I basically agree with what Shawn said. There are actually lots of problems, essentially, in this sector. And they often get conflated together, and it's not that hard to understand why they get conflated together, because affordability is something that obviously has an impact on how you can expand access for universal coverage. But where I'd start is to say national pharmacare is perhaps the wrong moniker to use, because it basically suggests a solution to the problem rather than allowing the problem to be explored a little bit more. Although, quite frankly, as an ex-policy advisor, everybody knows why we do this, right? We know how it's going to play out in the media. We know that you have to get your ducks in a row and get something very strong statement out there that's going to work in the universal space to at least pin your flags to the mast, you know, so that people know what you're talking about in terms of a, you know, what's a possible solution. So I don't criticise people who have used the moniker National Pharmacare. I just think we need to be careful about just simply criticising that, right? Because to me, what this is all about is a cry to have pharmaceuticals included in the universal healthcare program for Canada. That's it, right? It's it, you know, and Shawn mentioned, you know, it's everybody's aware of the history, everybody in this room anyway, is aware of the history of pharmaceuticals being left out of essentially Medicare in Canada close to 50 years ago. So that's the issue that people, I think, want to fix as best as we can understand. How big that problem is, yes, obviously there's going to be debate about that, but it still strikes me as a problem, right? And even while I kind of think your tax credit solution has some merit to it in some places, it's still not going to actually fix that problem because there will still be people who aren't covered under those circumstances, right? So that to me is the issue. That's what it is we're trying to achieve. Maybe I can have two more minutes.
We've locked the doors, yeah. So you can take as long as you want.
So essentially you're trying to fix that gap, right? And to fix that gap has a cost that largely is going to be borne by government. It's a publicly funded cost that's going to accrue. And of course, once you do that, you're into trying to find a way to make that affordable. Now, there's already an affordability problem. There's already a collective negotiating process that happens in Canada to try and control affordability. And yet, despite that, there's still going to be quite a significant cost expanding access to pharmaceuticals and including it in the universal health coverage. So what happens is you end up with this notion of suggesting a national formulary, you know, basically a core set of products that will be available that perhaps every province who looks after healthcare has to ensure is available to their population. And because we end up going down that route, suddenly we start talking about lack of choice, you know, and that fear of change in or a loss of choice, that fear around that. And this is why I have said right at the get-go, you will not see the New Zealand model arise in Canada, because New Zealand doesn't have deep, mature health insurance markets, right? And to me, Canada has that opportunity to not only get the universal coverage for a reasonable core of pharmaceuticals that will, you know, cover a lot of problematic illnesses, but it will also be able to have the ability to mitigate this fear of loss of choice through the private health insurance programs, right? So I'm a little bit more positive about the whole change, and you know, a dose of reality to me is a little bit negative, because I actually think that the counterfactual here is a collective coming together of the provinces to negotiate pharmaceutical prices. That is already happening, and that is not going away, and that won't change. And in my view, that's the counterfactual that you're looking at, right? Relative to that counterfactual, adding in this population simply expands the market. It's going to make it a bigger market for insurers, a bigger market for pharmaceutical companies. Not relative to the status quo, but relative to the counterfactual, where you've got provinces negotiating access conditions and prices collectively. So relative to that world, it seems to me, not only does this fix a problem, but it also expands the market. And so maybe that's a little bit of a controversial thing to say, and colleagues beside me will probably start to criticize me all around that, but that's where I think we're heading.
That's great. So we want to come back to that as we think about what solutions fall out of our thinking in and around the problem. But I think you're right to foreshadow that part of the conversation. Judith?
Great. Good morning, good afternoon. My name is Judy Glennie. I'm a clinical pharmacist by background with a history in teaching hospitals as a clinician and academia across the country, about 20-some-odd years in the public sector, in government, a governor and council appointee to the Patented Medicines Prices Review Board, worked with Health Canada's Health Products and Foods Branch for many years, and then was with the Ontario Ministry of Health with their Drug Programs Branch, also in industry for 5 years, and now consult, basically public policy or pharmaceutical policy consultant, so kind of like Matthew. I actually wanted to take us back to first principles around drug plans. Why did we create them in the first place back in the 70s or 80s or whenever it was? Yes, they were not included in national in Medicare sort of in the mid-60s, early 70s, because frankly at the time the drugs that we had were useless and were not worth paying for when we look back in retrospect. Drugs didn't play the role that they do today in terms of the impact that they have on long-term outcomes in patients, and sort of that's my little soliloquy. So when we started to have these drug plans popped up in the provinces, it was because we publicly and politically were making decisions about the importance of investing in population health and mitigating the impact of disease so that we could mitigate long-term health costs. And oh, by the way, just like with Medicare, we were doing it because we did not want to see people lose their homes because of the cost of their treatment. So fast forward to today, and I'll always be a public servant at heart. So in my gut, you know, the concept of an enhanced pharmacare, whatever we want to call it, but really more equitable access for all patients, access to important drugs that improve outcomes and mitigate healthcare costs, and sustainability of the healthcare system are all things that I very much believe in. But I think, as Matthew has said and Shawn has said, we really have no definition or common language that we are using when we talk about this concept or we talk about the problem. The challenges have been oversimplified enormously, whether you look at the House of Commons report or the Hoskins report, really oversimplifying what the challenges are. And then when we look at what the solutions might be, again, oversimplification of the solutions. Many people have written about pricing as being the big issue, and we got to negotiate prices, et cetera. As Matthew has said, we're already doing that. The provinces have been doing that for almost 10 years. And we're losing sight of the fact that at the end of the day, we actually want to achieve patient outcomes as well, positive patient health outcomes. And that, to me, should never be lost in the discussion that we have. It's been very focused on equity, which I think is a good thing, but it's also been focused on costs and not sufficiently on outcomes, which really is about investing in patients and in our healthcare system. And last but not least, one of the challenges or one of my concerns, having worked in a provincial government for many years, is the risk that if we take this up to a national level, which may or may not be the case, we lose that alignment between provincial health policies and priorities and the drugs that are available for patients. And like it or not, we are a country of multiple jurisdictions, and we actually do have very different, a lot of similar, but also very different health problems across the country. Rare diseases is a prime example where you will see pockets of patients with Fabry's disease, for instance, across the country, not evenly distributed. And so that may be more of a priority for some provinces than others. And there are many examples like that. So we always, you know, that need to keep alignment between the provinces and who actually support the delivery of the healthcare system with the drugs that are available to enable them to make those investments and in the areas that are a priority for them, to me, is a key issue. Thanks.
Shawn?
Thanks so much. So I have the great opportunity to go after everybody said everything that I want to say, so that's fantastic. So my name is Dr. Shawn Whatley. I'm a family doc in rural Mount Albert. We're rural, but not remote. I've also held leadership positions in large hospital, emergency medicine, locally at the Lynn, provincially at provincial boards, a medical association, national medical association boards. But I don't speak for any organization right now, but I am a Munk Senior Fellow, so hopefully that's enough of an introduction. I want to focus on outcomes and operations. So just those two things. When you said, what is the problem? And building on what Judy said, I can't tell you the number of tables I've sat around and patient outcomes either never get mentioned or they're the last thing that comes up on the agenda. Everything is about efficiency, cost, savings, policy, on and on. And so I'm really glad that Shawn opened the discussion by saying, what exactly are we trying to fix here? And so as a clinician, I'm coming at this from how can I improve the lives of the patients I'm trying to serve? And I think if we develop any sort of policy solution that doesn't have that front and center, I think we're missing something. I'm happy to debate that, but I throw that out there. Maybe that's a provocative statement. But I find that that's missing in most of our discussions. When we talk about a national drug plan, we're trying to fix, when it comes to health outcomes, cost-related non-adherence. That's the fancy word for saying people can't afford to buy their drugs, and so they get sick because of it. So CRNA accounts for a small proportion of why people don't take their drugs. But it's only one out of many other reasons why people don't take their drugs. I won't ask for a show of hands, but how many of you have not taken your drugs as you're supposed to? I mean, I'm on one medication. Yeah, we all do. Put your hands up. There are many other reasons for non-adherence besides cost. Many people who have free first dollar coverage for medications still don't take their medications because they don't like them or they're a bother or they forget or there's an interaction with alcohol or there are side effects. There are many, many reasons why we don't take our medications. So if we have free drugs from coast to coast, will that improve health? And so far in the literature, I haven't seen anyone be able to say conclusively that we are going to improve the health of Canadians by having a national Pharmacare plan. And then further to Sean's early comments as well, we already have in Ontario ODSB, Ontario Works, Home Care, Trillium. There are a number of plans already in place for our most vulnerable population. And then the second comment I'd like to make is with respect to operations or experience. What does it feel like when you're actually trying to care for patients at the front lines of care? So certainly in emergency medicine, the question I ask everybody, do you have a drug plan? Because that determines whether I give you a once-a-day treatment or whether you get one antibiotic that's really expensive or three antibiotics that are cheap or are covered by the Ontario Drug Formulary. Whether you get a fancy medication that costs a lot that has lower side effect profile or a more tolerable side effect profile. So when you have a drug plan, I'm just thinking about how to make you better versus cost. And although having the ODB, and I apologize, Judy was involved in creating the ODB, we love the Ontario Drug Benefits Plan. It's better than nothing. But there are many restrictions. There are only so many drugs that are available, and usually there are special little codes you have to enter, and so it's kind of a pain in the butt compared to a retail plan. So retail, at least on the front lines of care, works the best. And speaking to OHIP Plus experience in Ontario, there are over 4 million Ontarians under the age of 25 that were covered. Everybody got coverage when OHIP Plus came in. Well, that was good for the 1.2 million young people who didn't already have coverage, but 2.1 million of them already had plans. And a further 750,000 patients qualified for one of the other plans I mentioned, ODSP, Ontario Works, Home Care, Trillium. But only 218,000 out of the 750 were enrolled in those plans. And so it seemed really odd to create a wall-to-wall plan for these 4 million patients when there could have been a more thoughtful way to do it. Furthermore, OHIP Plus only covered 4,400 medications, whereas the typical retail plan covers between 12 and 14,000 medications. So as a clinician, talking to my patients who we've spent the last 2 years trying to work out a cocktail that improves their mental health condition, helps the kids function better in school. Finally, the teachers are happy. The principal's happy because the kid's not in the principal's office. The parents are happy. Everybody's happy. And now we have OHIP Plus, and we have to get rid of them all because you have to go on a trial of something else. Or you have to fill out EAP forms, Exceptional Access Program forms. So I am very worried about a national approach. Yes, sure, let's do it, depending on how it's done. So there seems to be no end to ways to make something clunky and difficult for patients when we're not thinking about health outcomes front and center. So I'll stop there. I have other comments, but that's long enough, probably.
That's great. So I think we'll go through another round or two of questions, and I know people here no doubt have perspectives they'd like to contribute. So I started with trying to coalesce around a common understanding of the problem. I think we've achieved that more so, I think, frankly, than we've observed in the public debate for the past 24 months or so. Maybe my second question, having talked a bit about the problem as we understand it, how should policymakers think about solutions that flow from that common understanding problem? And I'll start with you.
Yeah, so I will have to say is that I probably don't agree with a lot of what has been said. It sounds like everybody, you know, is saying no, a national pharmacare will not fix the problems and all the varied problems that there are. Obviously not. But that doesn't mean that we cannot have solutions that have a national consistency. And I don't think anybody's saying that that's not the case either. I mean, it's like saying having access to a family doctor is not going to make me a healthy person, but it doesn't mean that people shouldn't have access to a family doctor. Yeah, that's not going to fix everything. And we need to fix each and every one of the things you're talking about, you know, being able to get access to, being able to make sure that it works specifically. Go back to rare diseases for a second, not just because rare diseases, but because the kinds of drugs that we're having for rare diseases is the future of medicines for everybody. Yeah. We're talking precision medicines coming up. We're no longer going to be talking about, as Judy says, the drugs that don't do a whole lot in terms of really improving your conditions. We're not just talking about drugs that are going to be for the masses, where 60% of it may work for the masses, but 40% don't because we don't know any better. We're going to be able to do that. And I think that is where rare diseases are now. For the most part, patients with rare diseases do not get a drug that doesn't work for them because we already know what the cause of that disease is. We have drugs that are developed to actually treat that particular cause, sometimes genetic, sometimes around a host of symptoms. We also monitor and manage these symptoms of patients. They're not getting their medicines, and then we don't say goodbye, come back in a year. It doesn't happen that way. And they're also surrounded by other care. This is the future. I will tell you one of the big disappointments I have in speaking with one of the leads Dr. Hoskins in Pharmacare, was I asked him, I said, what are you guys thinking about in terms of cell and gene therapies in Pharmacare? How is that going to be accommodated? He says, we haven't thought about it. I said, you got to be kidding me. These are the most important therapies that are coming out. We're talking about potentially durable, long-term lasting, I hesitate to use the word curative therapies, and we're not thinking about it. And part of the problem is I hear everybody trying to fix yesterday's problems. Yesterday's drugs are not tomorrow's drugs. And we shouldn't even be fixing today's problems. If we're thinking about tomorrow's drugs, what are the therapies that are coming in? And what should we as Canada be doing in order to provide access to them? I mean, I said, you know, said many a times, if National Pharmacare looks a whole lot like today's public drug plans, forget it. It's not going to do anything for us. On the other hand, we have an opportunity with a nationally based solution to move towards the future.
How do you reconcile a national plan with the trend towards precision medicine as you describe?
Well, I'll give you again the example of what is being proposed for rare diseases, and it's something I do love about what the Hoskins proposal is, and that is you have an overall program that would actually make sure that people that have, you know, a certain condition or a certain, you know, genetic types would have all equitable access. So the challenge, as you're saying, with Fabry disease is what about the one or two patients who don't live in that population? We've had the case now where you got a big population that's got the rare disease in that province, they're getting access. You have one or two patients that are in, you know, in New Brunswick, in Saskatchewan. They have that disease, and the government says, not a big problem for us. It's only one or two people. So they don't get access. And this is, you know, so we need to have that. Then within it, what we need to make sure we're doing is we're setting up the right criteria for who gets access, because even with a precision drug, not everybody's going to be eligible. In fact, even more so, right? Who should get access? How do we define the criteria for determining who gets access? Mm. But that has to be not only national, it's got to be international. So we need to have that consistency. Then we have to have some agreement around how we're going to make that access available. And we've had things like the Fabry solution where we've got a panel that actually adjudicates it, and there may be some prioritization so that not everybody's getting it. And then within that, you also then say, what are we going to look for to make sure that it's working? How are we going to monitor it? Again, that's got to be done right across the board. You can't say, okay, New Brunswick will monitor for this, and then Manitoba will monitor for that, because we're not going to learn, right? So all of that has to be done. So the program, the criteria, the monitoring, the access, even the adjudication has to be done across the board. Now, whether it's one gigantic national, whether it's provinces that are collaborating and working together, whether it's different medical groups that are working together, all of that needs to be worked out. But it really does have to work as a collective. So, I mean, so the precision medicine doesn't mean that, okay, we're talking about just, you know, individuals. Precision medicine really demands more than anything else the ability to do it on a broad scale, and as I said, even internationally. And when we talk about, you know, concerns around affordability or pricing, I would say one of the biggest challenges I have with what's being proposed in National Pharmacare, it's kind of what Matthew kind of alluded to, and as we're trying to develop a Pharmacare program for the future that's based on the budgets for yesterday, ain't going to work that way. Yes, these medicines are expensive. Yes, these medicines can become increasingly expensive. Yes, we're paying a whole lot more for drugs than we ever did. But go back to what Judith said. We used to pay for drugs that didn't do a whole lot for you. Now we've got drugs that actually do a lot for you. Where do we want to be as Canadians? Do we want to be looking back and saying, okay, we'll provide a basic set of drugs for that were available 15 years ago, and then we'll be happy with that? Or are we going to look for it and say, what can we do? The other part I will say is what Canada doesn't do. And we had the ex-minister from Ireland speaking. We're not investing in research and development. We're not owning any of these therapies. We're just net buyers. Where's our investment in terms of developing these therapies, owning these therapies, so some of what we're paying actually comes back to us? We're not thinking in a way that's very strategic. So yes, I think we've got a lot that we could do on a national scale. And I don't think, as you said in the beginning, the word national pharmacare means a whole lot, may mean a whole lot of different things to people. To me, it's a big banner that says we've got to be working across the country on some consistencies, whether it's principles, whether it's programs, whether it's access, whether it's monitoring. But it doesn't necessarily mean, and, you know, I was accused in the media of not supporting, you know, a publicly funded, you know, national program. I've never gone one way or the other on it, to be honest with you. We don't really care. Under the rare disease program, what we would prefer is that everybody pour it into a common fund. But whether it comes out of the private sector and public sector combined, whether it comes all out of the public sector, I don't really care. But I do think it has to be managed consistently.
If it's any consolation, I get accused of worse things all the time. Yeah. Matt, do you want to?
Yeah. So I'd comment on the problem and the solution again. So I agree completely with Dehane about having pharmaceuticals in the universal health care program, to me, also implies that it's common across Canada, right? That it's not a different universal plan in each province. So I think that, because I think horizontal inequity is one of the things we tolerate least, it doesn't matter what sector we're working in, that causes a degree of strife. And it's that in itself is a problem worth solving, right? Differential access just because of your postcode, right? I don't think that makes a lot of sense.
Did I understand, Matthew, in your introductory, your first set of comments, though, that you would support a model that, in effect, tries to scale up the current hybrid system, that is, some form of catastrophic coverage in the private model, or probably in the public system, but an accompanying supplementary model to support the system as well?
Yeah, well, one of the things we talked about when we were preparing for this was just, you know, Canada's constitution and what's constitutionally possible in Canada. So I think, you know, you were put in a position of having to accept that the provinces are responsible for healthcare. And I'm not sure that the notion of establishing national program in itself is something that can actually be achieved constitutionally. So I think what you end up doing under those circumstances is pretty much what we've done for Medicare, which is basically you enact what it is that has to be covered, and you let the provinces find their own ways of dealing with this, right? So yes, I think you do end, under that kind of solution, you do end up with essentially a core formulary that's common to all provinces, right? That's what I'm calling it, a core formulary. I mean, other people might call it a catastrophic coverage formulary. That to me has its own overtones, which I don't really want to, ascribe to. To me, it's a evidence-based core formulary. It's a formulary that makes sense for getting good health outcomes as inexpensively as you possibly can, right? So that's where I start. In terms of, I did want to just react to, would that, making coverage universal across Canada, would that solve a health problem? I think undeniably that would solve a health problem. Not only an equity problem, which clearly there is, but a health problem, because And the bit of evidence that I think about the most, and I haven't seen anything to say that this evidence, is wrong, was a study done in Ontario by Booth in about 2012. Certainly a little outdated now, but nothing has changed that would necessarily change these results, where people with access to the public plans for treatments of diabetes got better access than those who didn't, right? With a sort of over a five-year period, about an 800 level of early mortality, 800 people dying early because they couldn't get access to insulin. Insulin. Are you kidding me? One of the oldest drugs around, invented in Canada, and you can't get access to insulin because you're, as you pointed out, in the gig economy, right? To me, it's undeniable that if that was on a common formulary and provinces had to make it available to everybody, regardless of whether or not they had an insurance plan, that would cause quite a substantial improvement in health outcomes in Canada. So there's a piece of evidence I think you have to work with and, sure, challenge it. Maybe the new research has to be done to see whether that's changed over time. But, recently I think there was a bulletin on CBC with, talking about a young woman who is experiencing exactly the same problem, only a month ago, suddenly discovers she's got diabetes but isn't covered, right? Of course, the other thing about diabetes drugs is it's not just the old ones and the cheap ones that you use anymore, you use the new and expensive ones. So, this becomes actually a very difficult problem for people to adhere to their medication because they simply can't afford it. So, I think you have to unlayer it. Yes, there's an equity problem. Yes, there's a common access problem across the country. How do you solve it? I think you have to work within the federation that we live in and find solutions within that. The idea of national pharmacare is a nice catchphrase, but I'm not sure that it's even possible within Canada, right? But that doesn't mean we should ignore the opportunity to try and achieve putting pharmaceuticals into that basket of universally covered services for health.
Judith?
So I'm gonna focus a little more on how do we work towards solutions. And I'm sure just about everybody in this room has done renovations at some point or time, and I'm sure you've heard from your contractor that you can have it fast, you can have it cheap, or you can have it good, but you can't have all of those. You can have two of those, but you can't have all three. And I think that same kind of a paradigm applies here, because I think we can have it good from a patient perspective, making sure that they have access to medications that help improve their health status. We can probably have it cheap, which is what the payers want, and probably cost-effective, which is what the health system needs from drugs as an investment in health. But in the short term, I'm not sure we can have all three. The long term, maybe. And that's why I really do think there's a short-term solution. And if I were advising the current government and looking for a deliverable, I think there are some potentially quick wins, whether it's a taxation-based approach, whether it's a rare disease pilot program that where you're working with the provinces to set something up so that there's equitable access across the country. But then the long term, the really getting down into the dirty of how do we truly ensure that there is equitable access to a broad rather than narrow range of drugs for all patients across the country so that everybody, no matter where they live, can ensure that they can have access to medications that will help treat their disease, keep them out of hospital, keep them productive, et cetera. That's a real, and in the context of federal-provincial relationships, et cetera, and sustainability, that's a long-term issue. And I think that, an issue that first cropped up in the National Forum on Health in 1995, then cropped up in the National Pharmaceutical Strategy in the mid-2000s. I mean, none of this is new to us. Endless royal commissions, et cetera. We've always done things incrementally, frankly, in this country. So let's at least try to get one more increment done as we work towards and discuss really a much more holistic approach and a real investment-based approach to pharmaceuticals within our healthcare system. That's kind of airy-fairy, I know that, but we don't necessarily have the right people around the table to come up with all of the solutions, but the fact that we're talking about maybe doing that, I think, is the most positive thing that I've seen in the last 20 years. And it frankly will be contingent on what happens in the election.
Shawn?
Yeah, great comments so far. We might be oversimplifying this by just saying pharmaceuticals writ large, because I think when you talk about pharmaceuticals for rare diseases versus pharmaceuticals for chronic diseases, those drugs are very common, a lot less costly, but people still don't take them, versus pharmaceuticals for acute care. So certainly we could delve into the nuances there. The evidence regarding cost-related non-adherence in a large review of Canadian data in 2018 by S. Gupta et al., so all the other authors there, they looked at over 700 studies. I think it was 734 studies, but don't quote me on that. It was over 700 studies that looked at cost-related non-adherence. And they found a range between 4% to as high as almost 36%, where this is an issue in some of these studies, for patients saying that I could not take my medication because of costs. And again, to Sean's opening remarks, it actually isn't the people with the greatest fiscal restraints. It's actually some people in the middle. To Matthew's comment, just because there isn't evidence to say that there is a concrete causal connection between not being able to take drugs and bad health outcomes doesn't mean there isn't a connection, right? We've never done a randomized controlled trial on parachutes, and no one will do an RCT on parachutes, right? So some things we have to take on a little bit of logic and say, yes, if you're not taking your insulin, you're probably going to get sick. And so I hope I didn't mislead you by suggesting that because we don't have evidence that there is no evidence there. My concern with asking, I think we ask the government to do too much. We ask the government to solve things that, number one, maybe it doesn't have to solve, and number two, maybe it's not the right tool in our tool chest to solve the problem we're trying to fix. And so politicians, it's great as a politician, and I've worked a little bit with political campaigns, to say, yes, we're going to develop this program, and it's going to be wonderful. Certainly even do this at the hospital level and at the provincial level, not with the political parties. It's wonderful to build and start and dream about a new program. It is very costly from a political point of view. Last 15 years I've spent in medical politics. It's very costly from a political point of view to start saying, this program really isn't working too well. And it doesn't just need more money. We have to do some major reorganization. Maybe we need to shift funds in a different direction. So that's my worry about going to the government with hat in hand and saying, here, please solve this for us. I'm not convinced that we won't end up with worse problems than some of the problems we're already facing, especially for acute needs for common medications and chronic needs for common medications. When you start getting into personalized medicine, genomics, proteomics, rare diseases, where there isn't a market, there's just no volume at all, I totally agree. We probably need to be looking at national solutions until we can develop more of a market base so that people actually have choice. But for most of the drugs we're talking about, we're not talking about the million-dollar medications. So then I would close with this. In the United Kingdom, they're very open about talking about rationing. Rationing is a reality in a centralized solution. You cannot solve everybody's problems. And they're very open about it. You say rationing in North America, people have a conniption. They're no, how dare you talk about rationing? I think we need to be more upfront about saying, what can we pay for? What trade-offs are we making by doing X when we'd also like to do X, Y, and Z altogether? And to close with Milton Friedman's provocative comment, you know, if the government was in charge of the Sahara Desert, we'd very soon have a shortage of sand.
Do you want to comment?
I don't want the shortage of sand.
I do think that what, you know, everybody is saying is that we cannot have one solution that addresses all problems. So the question is, what's the problem you're trying to solve is what you started with, right? If the problem you're trying to solve is how do we improve, you know, people getting, you know, in general, access to a broad range of medicines, if all those medicines are somewhat equivalent, and, you know, that's one question. If we're really talking about the question, how do we keep our drug costs contained regardless of what's coming, that's a very different question. And maybe those two fit together, I don't know. If we are talking about, as you say, how do we build plans that would allow us to, you know, make sure that where there are, in fact, some common, you know, and low-cost older drugs that are available, and they're available to everybody, and we can monitor their adherence and how they take them well, I think that's another solution. And within a drug program, you can have all those solutions because they're different. It's like having a hospital. You don't treat the patients that have cancers with the same way as you treat somebody who's coming in with acute, you know, injury, et cetera, et cetera. You have different kinds of programs in there in the hospital. You don't just say, okay, my patient came in the door. Here's your generic set of what you're going to have happen to you. So I think we can do that. And definitely, as we're moving towards these more precision medicines, which also includes then many of the drugs for rare diseases, we need to think differently. And I think in that thinking differently is a bit of what we do see has been proposed to us, and I like the elements of what's been proposed, including having some dedicated ways of providing access to those. And I worry a lot that Canada is kind of, you know, saying, well, as long as the majority of people are taken care of, we can be happy. You know, again, I just came back from the United Nations, came back from WHO. UN, you know, Sustainable Development Goals for 2030, their mantra is leave no one behind. At the WHO, we're talking about universal health coverage. Not to say we're going to just provide a blanket coverage, but because we want to take care of each and every person. Dr. Tedros was very clear when he said, no country can be said to actually achieving universal health coverage for its citizens unless it's taking care of those with rare diseases. And he said it specifically. We cannot leave those patients behind just because their numbers are few. And it doesn't have to be rare diseases. It can be any individual. It's like having a hospital. If you cannot take care of each and every person that walks in the door with a specified treatment plan, it's like being a family doctor. If you cannot take care of that patient with regard to what his and her specific needs are in within your general practice, then you cannot be said to achieve your duty. And guess what? We can do all of those. And so one of the things I do like coming forth is that there are mixtures. Like the UK, as you say, they have a highly specialized therapies program for those very expensive, small patient populations. Drugs are very specific. They came out with a cancers fund because, again, they saw that some of those drugs were very different. They quickly overran their budget, but that was a different story. but, you know, but that was the recognition, right? So I don't think we have to say national pharmacare and universal health coverage to say, yeah, it's just one blanket, you know, solution for everybody, and we'll all crawl under that same blanket. There's lots of little blankets in there. We can all huddle in terms of wherever we want to be that makes the most sense to us. But I would love to see us adopt the mantra that says, we are not going to leave anyone behind. And even if it's only one or two people, you know, that are going to be in that particular environment that need to have that care. We will think about how we can make that available. And I don't necessarily believe that we can't afford to do this. Yes, affordability is a huge issue. Yes, some of these medicines are terrifically priced, and some of them may absolutely be overpriced. I will be the first to say we need to look very hard at that. But we cannot use what we're going to say in terms of our budget and what we're allocating to drive the price. There's two very separate questions.
Yes.
Is it fair pricing?
Yes.
Is it good pricing? How much do we want to pay? That's
yes.
a very separate question. That's a very separate question. We don't want to use one to drive the other.
Maybe because I'm sensitive to time, and I we want to get as many people to able to weigh in as possible, especially since I think we've hopefully stimulated a healthy discussion. Maybe we'll just wrap up, Matthew, Judy, and Shawn, with any final observations before we turn to the audience.
Yeah, I'd make 2 points. One. You know, the reason governments are in this space is because there's market failure. I don't think there's any denial. The insurance market can't deal with this problem by itself, right? So that's why the government's in there. And so, you know, I find it, you know, difficult. I fully accept that having been in the public sector and worked in many public sector organizations, that they can certainly make a hash of, you know, of their ability to achieve their objectives. So, you know, organizations can do well and they can fail, whether they're public or private. The public ones tend to be way more visible than the private failures, of course. So that's one thing. I think that you have to have government in here to help correct a basic market failure. If there wasn't a market failure, then we really wouldn't be having this discussion. Sorry, the second issue is just briefly gone out of my head. I think, I'll just have to come back to it as when it comes back up, sorry.
Do you and Shawn have any
just
closing
quick,
observations?
Yeah, just if you didn't already know this before you came in the room, this area is very complicated. It's very complex.
And controversial,
yes, exactly. Doesn't mean it's not worth trying to work through solutions. It is long overdue. There were good reasons for pharmaceuticals not being integrated into Medicare at the beginning, but it's long overdue that they are. So the challenge is, how do we get there? One of the things that frankly most disappointed me about the work of Hoskins and the work of the House of Commons Committee, not that they didn't try to do good work, because I think they did. You know, people honestly came at it, but I don't think they had enough people either on the committees or supporting the committees who actually understood what they were hearing. It's one thing to listen to what is being said by the vast swaths of stakeholders that spoke to both of those groups. It's another thing to understand it and to be able to integrate it. And I said to one of the advisory council members, I said, my biggest disappointment is not one of you has any idea, including Dr. Hoskins, how a drug plan works. And that is a big failing. And so as we move forward, we really do need people around the table who know how these things work, both from a bureaucratic perspective, an industry perspective, a patient perspective, definitely, and a number of other factors as well. But that would be my plea as we move this forward.
Shawn?
I would just close by saying clearly this is a problem. Clearly we do have some patients who aren't getting the meds they need, and we need to figure that out. My concern is with respect to asking government to do more than it's really designed to do. Government's great at coming up with policies and ideas and analyses and stakeholder engagement, but it really struggles with implementation, because making those hard decisions that are required at the front lines of an operational process are just not in government's best interest to do most of the time, because you will make enemies and you will compromise your political support by making some of those hard decisions. So that's my worry, but no question, there is a problem. We should figure out a way to solve it, and I'm glad to be here.
Maybe just before I turn it over, if I can try to summarize what I think I've heard today, which is I think a conversation that reflects the diversity of perspectives that are out there on this issue. But I still think we were able to coalesce around some key points. One, that it would be a mistake to simply affirm the status quo. I think there is a view that there is a set of issues here that justifies the kind of policy thinking that's occurred here in Ottawa, within your organizations and within the country. Secondly, I think, broadly speaking, support for incrementalism. You know, that is to say, we've had a system that's evolved over more than 50 years. These are issues, obviously, of great importance to Canadians, to patients, to industry, and so on. And that as we think about the design and implementation of solutions, we have to be careful to build public support, to protect the care that people have come to understandably expect. I think Philip Cross is here. Philip is a Munk Senior Fellow. He had a wonderful column in the Financial Post last week about incrementalism, not as pejorative, but quite the opposite, that as we deal with complex issues, as Judy says, issues that are affecting Canadians, we need to be careful, we need to be incremental, we need to be able to build support as we go about improving and refining and adjusting a model that, well, there are no doubt problems, continues to serve large numbers of Canadians reasonably well. And so I think the responsibility on policymakers now is to ensure that we're building on the strengths of the current system and not risk disrupting the way it's serving people, not just for political reasons and the political risks associated with disrupting drug coverage and the healthcare system, but substantively as importantly. Grateful to all the panelists for participating and look forward to questions and comments from the audience. There's a microphone back there, so if you just raise your hand, we'll be sure to try to get as many of you as we can. We have about a half hour or 45 minutes. I think the first one's right there, and then we have one up here.
Keep going?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Hi, my name is Sebastian. I'm here from the Canadian Federation of Nurses Unions.
The mic's not on.
Microphone.
It is on? Just close? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. And I may be one of the only millennials in this room, so I thought I'd share a few anecdotes from my generation. I just wanted to pick up on one of the points which was made, which I think was that the public sector can be quite inefficient at delivering services. I think there's a lot of good examples, though, out there of the private sector in terms of insurance right now, which does actually a very poor job of providing adequate insurance. And I know that we there's discussion about 10% of Canadians are not insured, 20% are underinsured. I've always questioned that figure because I think that the concept of coverage sort of provides cover for people who may be nominally covered, but actually are dealing with enormous barriers to accessing their medications because of simple things like copays and deductibles. So I'll give you one example. I have a friend who's 31. For 10 years, she's had a life-threatening disease, and she's been employed for basically every single month except for maybe 6 months of those 10 years. She was in university before that, and she has out-of-pocketed $70,000 in copays, insurance premiums, and deductibles to be able to afford the coverage while being covered nominally by her employer's plan. Why? Because there's always a yearly cap. Why? Because there's always a copay that she has to cover. What disease does she have? Type 1 diabetes. She can't be cost-related non-adherence because she dies if she doesn't get her insulin, right? And so, you know, there's a lot of conversation about getting the silver bullet. Do we have the perfect system? Can't we just solve some basic things by moving forward with a system that would be able to at least provide her with some certainty and provide her certainly with the certainty that she has when she goes into the hospital, which is that she doesn't have to worry about those kinds of barriers that she does when it comes to medication.
Thanks. Does anyone want to? No? I think we have someone up here. Just raise your hand and we'll get to as many of you as we can. Right here.
Thank you, MLI, for holding this event. It's always a pleasure to attend one of your events, and thank you, panel, for coming and raising this issue. I'll give you a personal experience. I was 25 years old, and I had a terrible back pain. I went through medication, painkillers. I went through the circuit. Eventually, I went to a chiropractor. He would adjust me, and within about an hour or so, I would go back to the same problem. In fact, at one point, I was thinking that I should move next door to the chiropractor so I could be adjusted every hour. And eventually, he said to me, you know, Edward, this is not an ordinary problem. You have a rare disease, and by the time you're 30, you're going to be in a wheelchair for the rest of your life. You can imagine my disappointment. I was not yet 30, and I was going to be in a wheelchair for the rest of my life. My wife said to me one day, she said, look, there is a yoga class happening in a school nearby. Would you like to join it? So I said, why not? I went there, and I said to the teacher, here's my issue. Can you help me? Can you do something for me? She said, don't fool yourself. Nobody can help you except yourself. You know your body, and you'll be able to heal your body. So I ask you, does anyone on this panel feel that in Canada we are over-prescribed medication, over-hospitalized, over everything? We are not taught to know anything about our body. Shouldn't we invest a little bit of money to get to know our own body so that we can get to find out what's ailing us before it becomes a rare disease?
It's an interesting question. I don't know if the panel wants to comment on, we have the good doctor here inclined to respond.
Yeah. So first of all, congratulations. You clearly have proven that person wrong, right? You're over age 30 now, right? You said you'd be in a wheelchair, but you're looking great.
At that age, I was feeling 70. Today, I'm 77. I feel like I'm a 30.
Brilliant, brilliant. So you proved them wrong, and congratulations to you. Do we overtreat? Probably. Do people come to harm from our overtreatment and over-investigation? Absolutely. Do we overtreat and over-investigate because there's first dollar coverage for everything? Possibly. Some of the statistics seem to suggest that. But the deeper question you're getting at is, are we ready as Canadians to have a discussion about the demand side of the equation? We always talk about supply, acute care, drugs, doctors, nurses, pharmacists, but we don't talk about the demand side, what patients want, and do patients have any role to play in their own personal health outcome? You talked about educating yourself and taking care of yourself. That's a very difficult conversation to have, and I would be too scared to even start it. I can give you a few more anecdotes since we seem to be talking about diabetes a lot. I can picture in my mind at least six of my patients, and I only have a tiny practice, where I've told them, you know, I'm really sorry, but your labs show that you now have diabetes, type 2 diabetes. Your hemoglobin A1C is over 6.5%. And they say, no, I don't. I'm coming back in 3 months, doc. I will not have diabetes. And they come back in 3 or 6 months. They've lost 30. One lady lost 80 pounds. She said, this is not me. I'll show you who I am by the fall. And she did. She came back. She has 80 pounds less. Cholesterol is normal. Hemoglobin A1C is normal. Hypertension is gone. She's sleeping better. Fibromyalgia is cleared up. She had about 6 diseases that disappeared on her own volition. So I think we could frame it in the positive and empower patients and say, look how much you can do in some cases to improve your health status. However, there's also evidence to show that you can lose all the weight in the world, and for some people, their blood pressure only changes 10%, or maybe 10 millimeters of mercury. So it's a very difficult conversation to have. I think if we can frame it in the positive as empowering patients and saying, look, how can we support you to be as healthy as you can be? But at the same time, we have to be careful, I think, about shaming people into saying, you're sick because it's your fault. Patients already feel that. They come in and they feel like, oh, I ate too much red meat, that's why I got a cancer. And, oh, I didn't exercise enough, and that's why I smoked too much. We don't need to make patients feel more guilty, in my personal opinion. Maybe others disagree.
Just one other comment here before we go back to the...
I appreciate very much what you're saying, and I really do, also wish my husband had taken some of that earlier advice with his own cardiac condition. But on the flip side of it, of course, is how do we empower patients to actually come to the physician and actually get the physician to really listen when they're saying, you know, this is not right. You've given me a diagnosis. I know that's not the right diagnosis. And the physician says, no, no, you go home and just do this. Or parents who say, my child has something, you've diagnosed it as this, and this is not it. Certainly, and a rare disease is not the only example, but it's very, very obvious in there. The average patient with a rare disease takes 5 to 7 years to get to the right diagnosis, because most of the time, they come back and the physician says, no, there's nothing wrong with you, or it's this, just keep doing this. If they get up to 12 misdiagnoses and actually get treatments for the wrong diagnosis, and in some case, pushing them way back to be much more harmed than if they'd gotten the accurate diagnosis. So the goal, I think we're all trying to do, is how do we get to the accurate diagnosis and then be able to provide that patient with the right treatment? Because there's also the other side of it as well. Even when you get to the diagnosis, you may not be able to access the treatment. So I agree. What we want to do is to make sure that we empower people to actually be able to understand and to present their case in a way that actually can be acknowledged, and then give the healthcare provider all the tools possible to do the diagnosis and to bring that patient to the right treatment. I think that's what we all want. Right. So I hear what you're saying, and I think very much on the other side of it is also ensuring that if, in fact, the solutions. My daughter was a good example. They wanted to diagnose her as autistic, and I'm saying this child is not autistic. And we pursue that. I mean, so I think we want to be very careful to not fall into some easy diagnosis and then do much more harm. So going back to my sense of it, making sure we actually get to patient, people getting to right diagnosis, right treatment.
Yes, that's great. I think we have a question over here, and then there's one over there. Where's the, oh, Philip.
Yeah, I'm Philip Cross. I'm a fellow here at MLI. I'm also an economist. I'm somewhat taken aback that in over an hour of this conversation about expanding public spending on healthcare, there's been no talk about the cost. I mean, I look at provincial government finances in this country are in very poor shape. They're largely in poor shape because of the rising cost of healthcare. And yet, we're talking about a yet another expansion of government spending in the healthcare system. Where does it end?
Does anyone want to comment on that?
Start, at least. So just speaking for Ontario, where health is approximately 50% of the government's budget, and drugs are 5% of that. So drugs make up 10% of the entire healthcare budget in Ontario, and it's probably running around $5 billion a year, just for Ontario, and that's, you know, primarily seniors, some Trillium, social. So it's not the entire population of Ontario either. It's maybe 4 million people out of the 12 or 13 million people we have in Ontario. And cost management has been part of the dialogue forever in that drug plan. There used to be a time, certainly when I was there, when we added drugs to the formulary because they had been shown to be effective, provide value from a clinical perspective, and were cost effective, we added them to the formulary. And we were looking at those drugs from the perspective of what outcomes could we achieve. So, and what I mean by that is investing in patients to mitigate their disease so that we can offset other healthcare costs, whether it be, going to the hospitals, et cetera, et cetera. We seem to have lost sight of that concept, in my opinion. We still look at things from a cost-effectiveness perspective, but once we've decided that the drug is cost effective, then it's all about driving the price down, which is part of the sustainability issue. And that is happening on a daily basis. I don't think I'm not saying that's the wrong thing to do. I'm just saying that we have shifted. So we're still looking for drugs that are, well, from an investment perspective, but we just don't want to make the same amount of investment, is basically what provinces are saying. The additional incremental investment to address primarily, you know, from my perspective, those people who have nothing in terms of drug coverage and who really have no resources. You know, they can't put it on their credit card and get it back in their taxes 12 months later, et cetera. the amount of investment that that would take, in my humble opinion, would be minimal. And worthwhile in terms of the offset, because those patients still come to the healthcare system when they're not getting their diabetes treated, they're not getting their high blood pressure treated, when they're not getting all these other things treated. So we're paying for them. We're just paying for them in a more expensive way than if we were giving them drugs to mitigate some of those costs.
I would just say, I'd be remiss though if we didn't recognize, which I think is implicit in Philip's question, the Parliamentary Budget Office estimate is that a national pharmacare plan, as it defines it, would represent about a $20 billion incremental expense to Ottawa. In effect, it would be taking $12 billion of spending currently occurring inside private plans or by individuals and effectively nationalizing it. And as Philip says, at a time when our governments are facing fiscal challenges, it would be wrong to minimize that. I think that's part of the reason, not the only reason, why we've sought to pursue fill-the-gap options, which target the cohort that Judith's referring to, but in a way that is cognizant of the fiscal costs.
I think this is why we've been focused on decomposing the problem, right? Because there are lots of problems. There's no doubt that if you're going to expand access to cover these 10 to 20% of people, it's going to cost you, right? And it's going to fall into the public sector. There's simply no doubt about that. So the question is, how do you make that affordable? And there are lots of different answers to that. But I think that's why we end up with a label National Pharmacare. It's why we end up talking about affordability and conflating the two. There is a basic problem, I think, that people want to address, and that is the horizontal inequity that exists right now. Whether or not you go there is a question of affordability, ultimately. Governments have to make a choice between whether that's more important to their population or some other objective.
May I just make one other point, because I'd be remiss if I didn't. I mentioned the Parliamentary Budget Office report. I think one piece of that report that went underreported, if I can put it that way, is there was a lot of talk of the headline number, the $20.4 billion. But PBO estimates conservatively that program would grow on average of 3.1%, so outstripping economic growth, inflation, outstripping even the floor for the Canada Health Transfer. So not only would we be taking on a significant cost, one-time cost, obviously it would become one of the fastest growing line items in the federal budget. And as I say, that's something that that I think requires more thinking and analysis.
Which is then why people start talking about single buyer options and volume-based pricing, which is already occurring, to be clear. It's what they're asking is that, okay, in order to be able to manage that forecast expenditure, we need to be better. And of course, that's when the industry and other people start to get concerned, is what the consequences of that might mean for solving this problem.
So I go back to a question that Shawn asked at the very beginning, slightly differently. Who here does not know ways in which we're actually wasting money in our healthcare system, right? I mean, it goes back to Philip's question there. Is how do we actually shift out of all of that stuff we're pouring money into, including things like duplicate testing, blah, 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 drugs are not being tested. We all know that they're there. And they probably, if we address 1/100th of them, could easily pay for all of the stuff that we want to bring in, but we can't seem to get out of that. Argentina, when it introduced health technology assessment many years ago for their drugs, the first thing they commissioned that committee to do, can you tell us all the drugs we need to delist, to get rid of? They came up with 990-some drugs that they said, get out of there, so we can make some space for something else. Now, and I'm not saying that we need to full stop, but I would love to see, as you say, some commitment, even if it was just in the pharmacare space. What do we get rid of? If we can make a commitment to doing that and then incrementally bring in stuff, even us as patients would agree to some of that, because we do have to clear out some of that. And things like improving adherence so that we can make sure that when we're giving people something, it works. Or monitoring and following up. You know, my husband gets a year's worth of drugs and they say, come back next year. Nobody even knows if they're working or if he's taking them. For goodness sakes. I mean, sorry, I don't mean to pick on my husband all the time. But he does deserve it. No, but truly, if, yes, We need to systematically introduce all of those as well. We can't full stop bringing in new stuff, but it's absolutely the case. If we don't address those, then we're not going to be able to get ahead of the curve. And I don't think that we, you know, we've made any commitment to actually getting rid of some of that. And I'd be as interested in having commissions that would look at where are we wasting the monies, where is it not having an impact, and what do we need to get rid of in order for us to clear some headspace.
I think there's a question back there. Did you have a question, sir? So then there's a next question here. Thank you.
Hi, I'm here today with Diabetes Canada, and I wanted to thank the panelists for all of your comments. I think that many of the concerns that we at Diabetes Canada would have about how we can best approach a solution to this issue of access have been surfaced today, so I really appreciate that. We know that from surveys that we've conducted in the past that as many as 25% of people living with diabetes struggle to adhere to their treatment protocol due to cost, and that's unacceptable because, as I think we all know and as panelists have referred to, we can pay now or we can pay an awful lot more later. So my question for the panel is sort of a compound one, and it's partially, as I guess is often the case, a comment as well as a question. But one is that as I listened to the dialogue today, it struck me that what we're talking about is the need to take a systems approach and a kind of a holistic, thoughtful approach to solving this problem, which doesn't mean that we have to solve it all in one fell swoop, but that we need to look at it from a systems perspective. And I'm thinking about a value-based healthcare approach that has a focus on measurable, empirical improvements in patient health outcomes as the goal of any adjustments that we make to the healthcare system, as opposed to just cost reduction or efficiencies, and sort of what would your comments be on how we can factor that into this discussion? Secondly, representing and living with diabetes myself, I think it's important that we keep in mind as we talk about ensuring that everyone has access to the medications that they need, that people with certain conditions need not only medications, but also devices or medical supplies. I often quip that insulin doesn't do me much good if I can't afford syringes. And for some Canadians, that's a reality. And so how can we factor into this thinking that just as we're experiencing important innovations in drugs that are improving patient outcomes, we're also experiencing proliferation in medical technologies that are improving patient outcomes. And why aren't they regularly part of this discussion?
It's a great question.
I'll just take a quick stab. Yeah. You said pay now versus pay later, which is before you asked your question. I worry if we use treatment or prevention as purely done based on cost. If we frame the treatment of diabetes as a way to save money down the road, what if we get a study that shows it doesn't save money down the road, like they found with smokers, right? If you treat smoking, actually they live longer and cost more in the long run. It's better if they die early. Well, that's terrible. We should tell you to stop smoking, not because it saves money, but because it helps you, right? It makes you healthy. And we should treat diabetes for the same reason, not because it saves amputations down the road, but because it's good for you now. So I really, I get hives when I hear the prevention to save money later. Now, the value-based, I'm not going to say much about it. I'll let you guys answer that hard question because it's not easy. It's a big topic in the States right now. But I wanted to make one comment about the devices and supplies. That is one of the first things, again, when it emerged. You know, do you have a drug plan? The reason I ask people that is because if you have a drug plan, you get a really fancy air foam walker, removable cast that you can scratch yourself and wash the stink off, and it's really, really good, and you can walk. Whereas no drug plan, you get plaster, and you're in crutches for 6 weeks, and it's terrible and uncomfortable and smelly and the whole thing. That's just one device, and you can add up a long list of devices, so great point.
I'll start with the value-based healthcare. On the one hand, one could argue in Canada we sort of do value-based healthcare. In when we look at drugs, at least, through the health technology assessment process. And what we don't do well there is that we look at drugs very narrowly. We only look at those drugs from the impact that they have on the drug program. Sometimes we look at whether or not there's an impact on the health system. Very rarely do we look at impacts of drugs on broader societal support systems, et cetera, et cetera. So that's one part of value-based healthcare, the current buzzword. The other part of value-based healthcare is actually measuring and monitoring and assessing outcomes. And again, we don't do that well in Canada. We could. Intermittently, governments have done that after they've made policy decisions. And frankly, it's one, it's not within necessarily within their competencies. So they need to reach out more, I think, to academic groups or others to help them do that. Or it's left to others who sporadically, will do those assessments, primarily in academia. So we don't have a really good way of doing that. The argument, that costs money too. So where are we going to get the money to start reevaluating the decisions that we've made, which I think is the right thing to do? And I think, again, it's got to be a tailored approach for more population-based things like hypertension or diabetes. You may be able to look at database approaches. For rare diseases, you're probably looking at one of our favorite terms, managed access plans, where you can collect data with from individual patients. We keep having, again, I've been around a long time. We've had these discussions over the years. Will this now be the time that we start to move forward with them in pilot programs? I think potentially with the Provincial Territorial Working Group on Expensive Drugs for Rare Diseases and some of the work that they're thinking about, we may start again some piloting of these more targeted managed access program kinds of things. But that doesn't help us with the bigger picture investment in more chronic diseases and whether or not we're achieving anything through that, which I think are bigger questions.
That's great. Thanks, sir.
Good afternoon. Thank you. This is the green light. You're hearing me?
Yes.
Yep. Okay. I'm a recovering provincial bureaucrat from Alberta. What we see missing in this conversation, we're talking about national, we're talking about Pharmacare. Our health system has evolved in 13 different ways over a very long period of time. And that includes how the private and the public dynamic has worked, whether it's for pharmaceuticals or other products and services going forward. And contrary to what was stated a little earlier, the share of provincial budgets on average consumed by healthcare in Canada have dropped 8 to 10% in the last 10 years. So they've actually been more constrained going forward as a share of provincial expenditure growth. However, I take Quebec as an example, and I keep thinking we're running to state-of-the-art 1997 when Quebec brought its legislation in that founded its modern drug plan, because we seem talking about that PBO, et cetera. Quebec spends the fewest dollars per capita of any province in Canada on health care, yet they have the most generous drug benefit plan in Canada. Newfoundland and Labrador spends the most of any province in Canada on health care. This is public dollars, okay? And they have one of the, shall we say, least adequate publicly funded drug plans in Canada. So the issue that I'm coming across is the federal government, the role, the dynamic, the provincial side of it is, how do we deal with this allocation decision-making over time when this is their purview? Yes. Okay, going forward. So if you try to run it separately as a national drug plan, how do you integrate those 680 million prescriptions filled every year to keep a consistency across that local dynamic? Or if you do it in kind of an asymmetrical pharmacare model across Canada, how do you assure those decisions of allocation and resource utilization, in fact, maintain consistency over time?
Yeah, it's a great question. I'm sure I'm sure people have observations or comments in response?
I'll start. I mean, I think that, again, so looking at the budget, the federal budget, the announcement related to the Canadian Drug Agency, which would be doing things that are frankly already being done that were developed by the provinces in terms of drug evaluation and negotiations. One of the other line items in the budget was the creation of a national formulary, which is a rehash of National Forum on Health and National Pharmaceutical Strategy, with the intention of creating that common set of drugs across the country to create equity across the country. I don't necessarily have a problem with that, but the question is, and this has been raised by many patient groups over the years, is, are we going to get the bare minimum, or are we going to get the best program? And that's where the rubber hits the road. Are we going to go with, I'm going to say Ontario, because it tends to be the most generous program, but it's the most complicated as well? Or is it Newfoundland or Nova Scotia, where you have to jump through hoops to get to some of these special diabetes drugs, whereas if you're a First Nations person in Nova Scotia, you don't have to jump through those same hoops, or at least until recently that was the case. So, you know, it all depends. The devil is in the details. That may be one way, through that national formulary process, to come up with that standardized access for anybody, no matter where you are across the country. Again, we have to make sure that it's consistent with provincial health priorities as well, so that, and that's where kind of the upper, what the best program is, maybe is the best approach, because then at least there's probably some commonality around what drugs are there that align with individual provincial health priorities, health policy priorities. If it's the bottom, you know, sort of the minimalist approach, then I think we have huge problems.
Sure. So I couldn't resist jumping in with, when you talk about percentage of provincial budget spent on health care, we have to talk about what do we mean by provincial budget? Because if you look at own source revenue, certainly in the Maritime provinces, they're spending over upwards of 70% of their budget in some cases on healthcare costs if you eliminate debt payments, transfer payments, and Canadian health transfer, or equalization payments and Canadian health transfer payments. So when you mention Quebec, my back stiffens a bit. Whoa, they've got huge equalization payments and huge Canadian health transfer payments. So I hesitate to compliment them on how well they're doing on their provincial drug plan when the rest of the country is also transferring an awful lot of cash to them. And finally, your point about budgets leveling, sort of bending the cost curve, I'd agree with that, but that's typical of a centralized approach to, or nationalizing an industry where we have feast and famine. It grows at 7-8% per year, and then all of a sudden, boom, it's cut. And I don't see how that's good for patient care outcomes. So I'm glad you raised the question.
The only thing I would add is that, as Judith says, the devil is invariably in the details. It seems to me neither the House of Commons committee nor the Hoskins panel to date, at least as far as I can tell, have wrestled with this question adequately. To the extent to which I have analogous experience, in 2011, we made relatively small changes to the Canada Student Loans Program to enable loan forgiveness for doctors or nurses who chose to practice some time in underserviced communities. And we ran into a major obstacle with the province of Quebec on a relatively small initiative. It's hard to see how we can move forward with a single-payer national system, that is one operated by Ottawa, without having to confront that question. And so I'm grateful that you've raised it. I think we have another question, and then we're probably close to wrapping up. I'm sensitive to people's time.
Okay. My question relates to Big Pharma. I'm a retired federal public servant, and this is not geared towards who's in power right now, federally or provincially or any other idea. I guess I'm worried because I go on Google and punch in Pharmacare Canada, and up comes all this stuff. And you read there that Big Pharma doesn't want Pharmacare. I worry about transparency. I worry about drug prices. I worry that Canada right now is over at some committee. I read CBC did a really good article over the weekend. I think Kelly Crowe did an opinion thing. And it talks about Canada saying they don't want as much transparency in drug prices given that committee, and they decide something tomorrow. I guess what I think Big Pharma should have a social conscience. I'm not saying they don't, but the big problem for me in this whole thing is who's going in to lobby senators and the government of the day with their big government relations firms. And I'm not complaining, they're fabulous. I guess it worries, what about the little guy and the little gal, the little Canadian?
Hey, Simone?
Yeah, I thank you very much, and I appreciate, I think a lot of people know I sit on the steering committee for the Patent Medicines Price Review Board, the guidelines to regulatory reform, and I think we're all very sensitive. I mean, there's no doubt about it. There are lots of expensive drugs out there. There are lots of drugs that are undoubtedly probably priced at more than they could be or should be. I think we have not seen, for instance, drugs that have been on the, you know, on the market extent, you know, beyond their patent, have actually come way down in price the way they could. And I think those are all ways in which we could look at how do we get things to be much more, you know, fair, affordable, et cetera. And I think we should be driving towards that. I think the issue of transparency is huge. Again, I just came back from the WHO where, you know, the ambassador from Norway opened, you know, his statement by talking about the need for transparency. And he says, you know what, Norway has just done something we always said we would not do, and that is we're accepting rebates. He says, we know it's the wrong thing to do, but we have no other solution given the current status of how drugs are priced and marketed. And we agree, from a patient perspective, we would love to see total transparency. I think the challenge is that we all know is that drug pricing is international, drugs are developed internationally. It means that we need to do it globally. And we're seeing the WHO and others come in to say we need to have transparency here. Now that actually is an oversimplistic statement because what does that really mean? Does that mean I need every company to show me their R&D costs and then we're gonna make some assessments in there? The UK had a formula which it said if you made excessive or you made profits that were greater than what they were agreed to be, then you had to pay back. I think all of those are important. But I do think that Canada has an opportunity to actually step forward, to actually come and be much more enlightened in terms of how pricing is done. I will guarantee you the approach that we're taking right now with the PMPRB is the absolute wrong way to go. Because what it's trying to do is drive down prices and make transparency in a way that will put Canadians, patients especially, in jeopardy. We've got to do this internationally. I mean, we're listening this morning to Trump and he's out there and, you know, doing his trade deals, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And in the U.S., they've now just introduced, Florida's introduced a reimportation that says they're going to send their Medicaid people come up to buy drugs in Canada because they're so much cheaper. We realize we live in an international environment. Let's do this internationally. Let's do this smartly. Let's let Canada take some leadership. But we cannot, at the same time, sacrifice the Canadian patient to try to drive a solution that is not going to help internationally, does not get agreement internationally, and will harm us at the same time. So I agree, we need to do much more about that. And I will say, as patients, we do acknowledge we need to do a whole lot in terms of improving the pricing of drugs. We also need to make sure that affordability and what we've chosen as the budget is not the wedge that we use or the hammer that we use to say, this is the right price.
It's a great answer and an important subject. I'm glad you raised it. For those of you interested, the Macdonald-Laurier Institute has published a paper in 2018 on the subject of the PMPRB reviews, reforms rather, and we conducted a similar panel discussion in conjunction with its release, and I'd encourage people to take a look. It seeks to grapple with the tensions that you're describing between issues like access and affordability, between broader economic objectives and pricing and so on, and I'd encourage people to take a look. Maybe with that, I'm sensitive that we've kept you for a bit more than an hour and a half. I just want to make a couple of final comments. First of all, we're grateful for you to join us today. At the Macdonald-Laurier Institute, we see ourselves as a combination of conveners and in particular, our ability to bring together the dynamic people like we have today. But we're only able to do that if we have an audience. And so we're grateful that you're able to join us. And some of you who've supported our work over the years, similarly grateful. Most importantly, it seems to me that you take away some of the discussion today. You're almost like you're our multipliers. Many of you are on the front lines of these issues as elected officials, as public servants, as people in industry and patient organizations. And so hopefully this has helped to inform and shape the way that you think about these issues in what inevitably will be a major issue, not just in the short term, but for the foreseeable future. So thank you so much for joining us today, and thank you in particular to our panelists for enlightening us and enlivening us and even provoking us. Thank you very much.